any sand sculptor can tell you around the world is that is only sand and water. You see these big boxes full of sand, and those boxes come off. We remove the nails, take away the wood, and there's a nice block of sand that you can sculpt into.
Jill Harris has sand in her shoes and in her soul. The sand sculptor and event organizer has been brought in by the Brevard Cultural Alliance to make the Art of Sand Festival a reality. She and sensational sand sculpting partner Thomas Coote will be joined by more than a dozen of the world's best sand sculptors at Space Coast Stadium on Florida's East Central Coast, where they will build an elaborate exhibit that will last less than 2 weeks. It's late September 2011. While organizers survey the grounds and plan the October festival, the raw materials are growing into a mountain in the back parking lot.
In the sand sculpting community, we call the packing process the pound up, because we were pounding the sand and building it up. So you have a 2-foot form. Everything is in 2-foot increments. It seems to work very well. Easy to climb on as well. And sand and water, compact it. Sand and water, compact it until it's full. And then you put a smaller form on top, and you just do that until you're at the height that you want to go.
Sand from a beach has been rolling around in the ocean. It's like a giant rock tumbler. So all those grains are round like marbles.
And if you try to stack marbles on top of each other, they slide off of each other. Sand from a quarry is going to be angular, flat, have some edges.
And that's why I can do this with this sand and it doesn't fall apart. But I can't do that with the beach sand here in Central Florida.
It's the essential ingredient in Art of Sand, and turning it into a short-lived sculpture garden will be a battle against the weather and a race against the clock.
I think you have to be a little bit flexible with sand, because it can be something falls off or some part was not so good, or you just see how it looks, how is the sun, or things like that.
It's got a lot of edges on it, and it holds itself together, it binds for a while, so it's better than most sands. But you still have to realize it is sand. And sand likes to stand like it comes out of an hourglass at about 45 degrees. And when you start doing this with sand, and this with sand, and this with sand, it's got to be pretty good sand.
For Art of Sand, we want to have a nice variety. There's a variety of styles, a variety of themes, and we have an overall blanketing theme, but the artists were allowed to really branch off from there.
I'm playing with the idea of a Chinese whisper under the overall theme of travelers. I'm playing with the idea of how a word can change and mutate between people. First day, you kind of have to get to know the sand and what it's going to allow you to do, what it's not going to allow you to do, what you figure you can trick it into doing.
Behind me is my piece, Time Travel. And I guess we're going to spend 8 days carving this in really, really beautiful sand. It's very, very buttery to carve. I'm working with clocks, and I'm working with the idea of a time is a rubber band. It's a line from a song that I like a lot. And so time stretching, time not having a constant ratio.
I'm doing a piece for my sweetheart and me about our travels in life and where we're at right now and our next step in life. It's not real deep or complicated, but it's going to be a fun fantasy piece.
I did a lot of research, and I've learned a lot about the train circus and, you know, different stops and how the trains were actually designed to go on and off the rails. It was just very inspiring, so that led me to doing this piece.
Then I'll be sculpting 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. I'll be doing the Nautilus, the Captain Nemo's submarine. I'll have a giant squid attacking that submarine. I'll have a diver in the water and a hammerhead shark and coral reef scene.
I'm sculpting a cycle of going through emotions, like falling down, and then you are really depressed, and then afterwards you have to struggle to get up again and find balance in the end. So I make 4 panels.
And mine is a story about Quebec City. It's at home we have a lumber, then a guy cut the wood, and they go during the winters for 6 months. And they make a pact with the devil. To the devil can bring them by a canoe to see the wife, but they can't touch the wife. Otherwise, if they touch the wife, the devil bring them to the hell.
It's my idea. There's a girl that have a dreaming with open eyes, and she dematerialized, and she threw in this idea, in this dreaming.
On one side of my sculpture, I'm showing a boy sitting on a rooftop of the house and looking at the stars and hope that one day he can reach the stars. From what I know, a human only can reach to the moon at this moment. So for the boy, it's a dream to go to the stars.
And my piece is the Indian story spirit. They travel from the sorcerer and the Indian chief, and the kids learn about the spirit.
My piece is called Route 66, The American Way. And what I'm trying to depict in my piece is a little more of a literal translation of the travel motif. Route 66 runs right near where I live in St. Louis, old sections of Route 66, and it's just been a big part of my life. I want to make it look like the motif of some of the old Route 66 postcards, you know, with the big lettering, with the graphics in the middle.
The sculpture is based on the Odyssey, which is a poem about Odysseus, who is making a very long travel, many years. So I thought it was a very good fit with this theme. And in this, on his travel, he has a lot of adventures and many interesting things happen. So I'm making a sorceress here, sir, who is living on an island. And the men of Odysseus come to the island and they explore, and they find her in her house, and she turns them all into pigs.
Jill Harris and I, we are sculpting our big daily commute sculpture. Well, what we wanted to do is to show the people, they're all like worker bees, all heading to work in some big anonymous city and doing all their boring work, and then they head home and they're really, really happy to go home.
No, this is the happy side.
Oh, okay, this is the happy side. Yeah.
First challenge is, which is a fun challenge, I'm working with Leonardo. His piece is on one side, mine's on the other, and we didn't know what the other person was carving, so it's not a problem of working on opposite sides, it's just making sure that the profile line works for both of us and you're not seeing part of the other person's sculpture that makes absolutely no sense appear on your side of the sculpture. It's been a little bit of a struggle, and right now we're just dealing with a lot of wind.
It's a straw, and if you cut the line, sometimes there's some sand crumble still laying there and you can just blow it away. Although we don't need it very much with the wind.
The wind will blow away all of your detail. So then you'll have this really interesting shape and no detail in it. What we do is we have a large sprayer filled with water, put about 1/4 inch of Elmer's glue, basic glue, makes the water white. Spray it on the outside of the sculpture and it creates a crust. And that crust holds that detail shape in place so it doesn't blow away.
The spray we put on is after we've completed a sculpture, completed a section that we don't want to touch anymore. We'll spray a windscreen on it. It basically just soaks in just a little bit on the surface, keeps the wind from blowing it away, and then when it rains, keeps the raindrops from pitting the surface.
There was a few pieces that had like small pieces that maybe fell off or had a little bit of damage, but at this point in our sculpting schedule, it's very easy to go back and make a repair.
This has happened, we know, and we just try to do it, and now just need to repair, that's it.
The weather, it's more of an issue because it's just no fun to work in bad weather. Pretty much the only thing we don't work in is lightning. You know, you'll see, we did a project in England and it rained every day, nonstop, no bread for 10 days. 10 days. It was absolutely miserable. Nothing ever got dry. You were just soggy. But you do it, and you still end up with a good result. But you have to adjust. You have to adjust your sculpting to the weather. Maybe you can't have the deep overhangs that you wanted to have before because you know it's going to saturate and not hold. So you have to support everything even further. And then you wonder, okay, rain's okay, torrential rain is not okay. Am I going to get torrential rain? Am I going to have damage out here? You know, and right now the sun gods are smiling on me saying that, hey, you can have your sand. But I think I'm going to end up with a rainbow because though the sun is out, I feel a little bit of rain. But thus is the life of a sand sculptor.
this conspiracy of clouds is what will become known as the no-name storm, a blast of wind and rain that lasts from October 7th to October 10th. At its peak, a wind gust of 81 miles per hour, hurricane strength, is recorded at Playa Linda Beach in northern Brevard County. A 60-mile-per-hour gust is noted at nearby Patrick Air Force Base. What's left is a muddy mess, along with dismaying damage to some of the sculptures, with time running out before the VIP opening of the festival.
It's very frustrating, and regular rain is okay. You know, you can see we had torrential rain, all day weather event, 11 inches of rain on this side alone, and I still have everything still standing. They're quite solid, but my detail is gone. If it was just a regular rain shower, nothing would have happened.
It's very sad, but we're all shoveling now, and it's okay. Tomorrow it will be a little bit more sunny, I think. And we can work, we can continue, and make something beautiful again.
Time has no meaning. Time is a rubber band. Let me see what a cliche is I can come up with.
Finally, fair weather has given the artists a chance to make excellent progress, but the only way they can hope to begin to make up the time they've lost is to work late. The stadium turns on the lights. Final hours of sculpting, the artists help one another out, putting finishing touches on their incredible sculptures.
Bringing in the rock stars of the sand sculpting world, and they're here tonight.
We wanted them to dig deep into their imaginations to present something very interesting for you to look at. This year's Art of Sand theme is travelers.
We have a fanfare. Hit it. And please follow it. Let's go see the art of sand. Thank you and welcome.
I think it takes tremendous ability.
There are some very talented people out in this world that I had no idea could do this kind of work.
There's a lot of cool sand sculptors. There is a kid zone. There is a giant field that you can run around if you want to.
It's just absolutely amazing how they've been able to create these images in sand.
It's just a pile of sand when they start, and the little minute detail that they put into it, I'm stunned. I really would like to know how they actually do it.
It's phenomenal. I just can't believe that they can do something like that.
Or as the French say, relieved. Usually the day after you finish work is your body just crashes. We managed to get it all done last night against the odds.
I'm really, really euphoric, happy because, it's a beautiful park, great turnout. I'm impressed with all of the different ideas that everybody came up with for the theme of travel, and I'm really, really happy to be here.
Doesn't matter how little time you get, you find the appropriate solution, and you get it done some way.
A foot of rain is a big weather difficulty. That's pretty impressive amount of rain. But the sculptures held up very, very well. We had to do repairs, but it wasn't as huge as you would think for that much.
The festival goes fast. Visitors enjoy the sculptures and dig into the sand themselves. There's a corporate challenge and a kids' challenge, art and entertainment. Most of the sculptors have gone, but Marion, Jill, and Thomas keep working, demonstrating the magic that goes into this fleeting art.
It has been an incredible few weeks with shoveling and hammering and sculpting and rain and wind and crowds and children and seniors, and it's been really a fantastic festival. We couldn't have asked for better weather for during the festival. I'm glad that when we had the bad weather that the artists had to deal with it and not the crowd. So I think it was a success. The feedback that we received from the public was very positive, and they seemed to really appreciate the art.
The festival is over. It's a bittersweet moment for the sculptors as the sand runs out of the hourglass.
I compare it to like an ice skating performance, any Olympic gymnastics or ice skating. You watch it, when it's over, it's over. All you have is the memory of it. And so we have plenty of pictures, plenty of videos, and we just move on to the next event.
I started on the beach, tide got it at the end of the day, kids jump on it. For me, this is a long-term sculpture.
I gotta tell you, it still does bother me to see my babies go down, you know?
The only time that's sad when you have to knock down a sculpture is when people don't come out to watch it. It's like a Thanksgiving meal or Christmas. It's just a lot of effort to make it all happen, and you hope that it's gonna create many, you know, good memories for a lot of people.
covered with sand, you got it in your ears, it's all kind of gritty in your teeth, but there's nothing that beats the feeling of a job well done and a satisfying day, and you're watching your artwork unfold before your eyes, and there's nothing that can touch that. It's fabulous.